In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
My brothers and sisters, this weekend we celebrate the Assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary, when our Blessed Mother was assumed into heaven to take her rightful place among the saints and her Son, Jesus Christ. So as we celebrate this great mystery and acknowledge her special role in our lives and in the church, let us first call to mind our sins and ask that her Son, Jesus Christ, meet us in our deepest needs. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned, that in my thoughts and in my words, and what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask the Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who assumed the Immaculate Virgin Mary, the mother of your Son, body and soul into heavenly glory, grant, we pray, that always attentive to the things that are above, we may merit to be sharers of her glory. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Revelation. God's temple in heaven was opened, and the Ark of His covenant could be seen in the temple. A great sign appeared in the sky, a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon beneath her feet, and on her head a crown of 12 stars. She was with child and wailed aloud in pain as she labored to give birth. Then another sign appeared in the sky. It was a huge red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns, and on its heads were 7 diadems. Its tail swept away a third of the stars in the sky and hurled them down to the earth. Then the dragon stood before the woman about to give birth to devour her child when she gave birth. She gave birth to a son, a male child, destined to rule all the nations with an iron rod. Her child was caught up to God and His throne. The woman herself fled into the desert, where she had a place prepared by God. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, "Now have salvation and power come, and the kingdom of our God and the authority of His anointed one." The word of the Lord.
The Queen stands at your right hand, arrayed in gold. The Queen stands at your right hand, arrayed in gold. The Queen takes her place at your right hand in gold of Ophir. The Queen stands at your right hand, arrayed in gold. Hear, O daughter, and see, turn your ear, forget your people and your father's house. The Queen stands at your right hand, arrayed in gold. So shall the King desire your beauty, for He is your Lord. The Queen stands at your right hand, arrayed in gold. They are born in with gladness and joy. They enter the palace of the King. The Queen stands at your right hand, arrayed in gold.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through man, the resurrection of the dead came also through man. For just as in Adam all die, so too in Christ shall all be brought to life, but each one in proper order. Christ, the first fruits, then at his coming, those who belong to Christ, then comes the end, when he hands over the kingdom to his God and Father, when he has destroyed every sovereignty and every authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death, for he subjected everything under his feet. The word of the Lord.
May the Lord God be on your heart and on your...
With you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
Mary set out and traveled to the hill country in haste to a town of Judah, where she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the infant leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth, filled with the Holy Spirit, cried out in a loud voice and said, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And how does this happen to me, that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For at the moment the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the infant in my womb leapt for joy. Blessed are you who believed that what was spoken to you by the Lord would be fulfilled." And Mary said, "My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked upon his lowly servant. From this day, all generations will call me blessed. The Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. He has mercy on those who fear him in every generation. He has shown the strength of his arms. He has scattered the proud in their conceit. He has cast down the mighty from their thrones, and he has lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has come to the help of his servant Israel. For he has remembered his promise of mercy, the promise he made to his fathers, to Abraham and his children forever." Mary remained with her about 3 months and then returned to her home. The Gospel of the Lord. Today's gospel reading describes an encounter between two women who are both common and uncommon. Common because they both came from families that were poor, but uncommon because Elizabeth was the mother of the soon-to-be-born John the Baptist, and Mary was the mother of the soon-to-be-born Jesus. When Elizabeth greets Mary, something incredible happens. Instead of hugs or small talk that you might expect from cousins, the Holy Spirit steps in to ensure that this historic meeting between Elizabeth and Mary and between John the Baptist and Jesus the Christ is remembered for all time. At the sound of Mary's voice, John the Baptist leaps in the womb of Elizabeth, and the Holy Spirit inspires Elizabeth to greet Mary in a special way, in a way so memorable that we repeat it every time we pray the Hail Mary prayer. Elizabeth says, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb." And if that is not enough, Mary greets Elizabeth in a manner that has also been remembered in prayer through the centuries. Her reply is called the Canticle of Mary, and it's a prayer that's so important that all ordained clergy are required to pray this prayer daily. The Canticle of Mary is a tremendous prayer, one that tells us about God's relationship with the people of Israel and of God's ongoing relationship with all Christians. Listen to this greeting, this prayer, inspired by the Holy Spirit. And as you listen to it, think what these words meant to Mary, who had been told that she would be giving birth to the Son of God. As she hears herself say these words, inspired by the Spirit, and also what they would mean to us today. And it goes like this. My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on his lowly servant. From this day all generations will call me blessed. The Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. He has mercy on those who fear him in every generation. He has shown the strength of his arms. He has scattered the proud in their conceit. He has cast down the mighty from their thrones, and he has lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has come to the help of his servant Israel, for he has remembered his promise of mercy, the promise he made to our fathers, to Abraham, and his children forever. Jesus is that promise. Jesus is the promise that God made to Abraham and his children and their children until this gospel reading with Mary. The Canticle of Mary reminds us that God, having seen the human race fall under the power of sin and death, God decided to help us. God's love for us was so great that God decided to send Jesus to live among us as part of his great plan of our salvation, to free us from the burden of sin and to guide us towards salvation. On this Feast of the Assumption, we should remember that Mary is an essential part of God's plan of salvation. Mary was conceived without original sin. And like her son Jesus, Mary would go on to live her entire life without sinning. Mary chose to say yes to God, and in doing so, she allowed God's plan of salvation to occur. Her yes was instrumental. It was not forced on her. She said yes willingly. Mary would go on to endure a lifetime of trial and sorrow, but she did so out of love of God and love for each of us. When Mary's time on earth was completed, Mary was assumed into heaven, body and soul, not by her own power, like Jesus who ascended, but by the power of God. Mary's constant message for us is to turn to her son Jesus with our burdens and our concerns. And if we ask Mary to, she will intercede for us. But in return, she wants us to turn our eyes to Jesus, not to her, but to Jesus. Mary constantly tells us to pray and has even given us a special tool to help with this prayer, the rosary. The rosary has been a part of our faith community for centuries. Saint Padre Pio called the rosary a weapon against the evils of the world. He said that with the rosary, we can defeat all evil. The rosary has been called the gospel on chains because as we meditate bead by bead on the various mysteries of the rosary, we learn about the most important moments of the life of Jesus. Before most people in this world knew how to read, it was the rosary that was used to teach them about the gospel and about Jesus. Even today, the rosary remains one of the best teachers of our faith. I say the rosary almost every day, and I do so because I've always had a special devotion to Mary. There were times in my life when I was younger that I had difficulty relating to this all-powerful God. I felt I was too sinful, too undeserving. But I never felt that way with Mary. To me, Mary acted as a type of lens that I would use to focus my prayers to God through. And as I have grown, I've developed a strong relationship with God the Father and with the Son and with the Holy Spirit. But my relationship with Mary and the rosary remains a bedrock in my faith. In this time of pandemic, relying on the basic tools of our faith is a really good idea. Relying on the Bible, the sacraments of Eucharist and reconciliation, and relying on Mary through the rosary will always give us strength. In this time of doubt and concern, remembering Mary and the example that she gives us and the tool that she gives us is something that truly can inspire hope within all of us.
Together now, let us profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us now turn to God our Father with prayers for our church and for the needs of the whole world.
For the church on earth, may we, through the intervention and intercession of Mary, our mother, continue to grow in faith, hope, and love. We pray to the Lord. For civic leaders and all those entrusted with creating policy, may the spirit of wisdom guide their decisions. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are hungry for community and friendship, may the Lord provide for them encouraging relationships of love and care. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those awaiting the birth of a child, that they have loved ones like Elizabeth to support them. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our parish community, that we may look to Mary in times of sorrow and joy, knowing she brings every prayer to Christ her Son. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intentions of the benefactors of this Mass, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the faithful departed, all the intentions listed in our book of prayers, and for all of our own intentions, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. God, our Father, your love for us is unfailing. Please answer our prayers this day, for we make them all through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
My soul doth glory in your love, O Lord. My soul doth glory in your love, O Lord. For you gazed on your servant with compassion, and you reached out and took me by the great are you, God, and holy is your name. Your mercy reaches to the end of time. Ah, the lowly you raise to the heavens, and the proud-hearted have no part with you.
Pray, sisters, pray, brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, our Father Almighty.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands
for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
May this oblation, our tribute of homage, rise up to you, O Lord, and through the intercession of the most blessed Virgin Mary, whom you assumed into heaven, may our hearts aflame with fire of love constantly long for you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For today the Virgin Mother of God was assumed into heaven. As the beginning and image of your church, come to perfection in a sign of sure hope and comfort to your pilgrim people. Rightly, you would not allow her to see the corruption of the tomb, since from her own body she marvelously brought forth your incarnate Son, the author of all life. And so, in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we proclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you've created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and you make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. In giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may attain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, Thomas, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory. Through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we wait the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not in our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Lamb of God, you
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. At this time, you can make your spiritual communion at home. Let us pray. Having received the sacrament of salvation, we ask you to grant, O Lord, that through the intercession of the Blessed Virgin Mary, whom you assumed into heaven, we may be brought to the glory of the resurrection. Through Christ our Lord.
Oh!
This weekend, I want to give an invitation to a couple opportunities here in the parish in the coming weeks. Starting today, this afternoon, we're going to have a three-day parish mission called the 99 Experience. Most of us are familiar with Jesus' parable of the lost sheep, the one whom the shepherd leaves the flock of 99 in the wilderness. And while many have heard the story many times, we may have not ever considered our role in it. We may have never asked, am I part of the 99, or am I the one who has gone astray? The 99 Experience is a three-session parish mission that will help us determine if we're the one or we're part of the 99, and sometimes both. So each session will focus on three short videos and small group discussion with an opportunity to spend some quiet time with God after session two and three. So please join us for this three-day mission, again, which begins today, August 15th from 3 until 4:30 p.m., and then Monday and Tuesday, tomorrow and Tuesday from 6:30 p.m. until 8 p.m., and all this will happen in the gathering space here at the church. There's no cost to attend, nor registration required. Just contact the parish office if you have any questions. Also, we have a new scripture study beginning. It's called Revelation, the Kingdom Yet to Come. Perhaps no book in the Bible fascinates people more than the book of Revelation, yet relatively few people have studied the book, especially from a Catholic perspective. This Bible study is an intriguing one that shows how the kingdom established by Christ in this church is intimately connected with the kingdom of heaven. Our parish will begin an 11-week Bible study on September the 2nd at 6:30 p.m. in the Gathering Space meeting room. Participants will meet every week to view an engaging video, followed by a time of group discussion and fellowship. If you're looking for more information or you'd like to register, please contact the parish office. The cost of the workbook for this study is $27. A Zoom option will also be available on the same dates and times, so please contact Jennifer to register or the parish office in the coming days. We'd like all people who are going to register to let us know by tomorrow, but again, maybe Tuesday at the latest. Again, if you have any questions, contact the parish office. With that, I hope everyone has a blessed week. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus, O Maria. August 8th began World Breastfeeding Week. WBW 2021 focused on how breastfeeding contributes to the survival, health, and well-being of all, and the imperative to protect breastfeeding worldwide. Support of the individual is very important. Breastfeeding must be considered a public health issue that requires investment at all levels, including health systems, workplaces, and communities at all levels of society. It's time to inform, anchor, engage, and galvanize action to protect breastfeeding. Inform people about the importance of protecting breastfeeding. Anchor support as a vital public health responsibility. Engage individuals and organizations for greater impact, and galvanize action to protect and improve public health. Only 2 in 5 children in lower and middle income countries are breastfed in the first hour of life. The World Health Assembly aims to increase the global rate of exclusive breastfeeding to at least 25% by 2025. Exclusive breastfeeding is the cornerstone of a child's survival and health. It provides essential, irreplaceable nutrition for growth and development. It provides a child's first immunization, protecting against 4 respiratory infections, diarrheal disease, and other life-threatening ailments. Exclusive breastfeeding has also a protective effect against obesity and certain non-communicable diseases later in life. Inadequate rates of breastfeeding result from social and cultural systems, health and commercial factors, as well as poor knowledge. Factors include, 1, the caregiver and societal beliefs that infants need additional liquids and solids before 6 months. Health systems not supporting of breastfeeding with a lack of skilled support. Aggressive support of infant formulas and milk powder substitutes. And 4, inadequate maternity leave and poor workplace policies when a woman returns to work. Breastfeeding can be linked to all 17 of the United Nations Sustainable Goals for Development. Breastfeeding is not just a one-woman job. It requires government leadership and support from families, communities, workplaces, and the health system to make it work. Thank you for your attention, and so long from the cozy corner.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord. Teach us wisdom. Hail Mary.